Greetings to you. We're so glad you have joined this service of the Emmanuel Baptist Church. We'd like to open our service with a verse from Psalm 118. This is the day the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I'll say the first half, and those of you at home know to say the second half. This is the day the Lord hath made. That's true. We are in the process of accepting applications for a children's ministry position that we've expanded up to 35 hours with a little better package. And so we're starting to get some resumes in. If you have thought about that or know of someone that maybe wants to apply, really need to get that resume in by June 7th. We also usually bring out our scholarship fund and remind people that if you are going to school and you would like to make an application to our the Emmanuel Scholarship Fund, that you need to call the office and get an application. And that needs to be in by the end of June in order to be considered for some school funds. Also, our services will continue on Facebook Live at 10:45 on Sunday. You can also see it on YouTube. The best way to find it would be to go to our website, ebcwv.com, and then in the upper right-hand corner of the homepage, you'll see the link for Facebook and the link for YouTube. We also, this week, it looks like we're definitely going to have in-person services beginning on June 7th, and we'll have a 9:30 service. There's going to be a whole series of safety guidelines which we will make you aware of. We will send everyone in the church a letter. It'll also be part of the newsletter that we send out. So we will be having an in-person service soon. This service will continue as is for the time being. We're so glad that you're with us. This last week, I was able to go home to Missouri and spent 4 days with my dad. He's 92 years old, and traveling around the city where I grew up. And it was just, it was great to be in that place where so many people and so many family fed into my life. And I was left thinking, God, you're so good. I just see your hand in every part of my life. And even though it's tough right now, this song, Goodness of God, came back to us. We'd like to share it again with you. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. The moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In the darkest night, you were close like no other. I've known you as a father. Known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is wonderful, it's wonderful to me. Your goodness is wonderful, it's wonderful to me. With my life laid down, I surrender now, give you everything. wonderful to me. Your goodness is wonderful, it's wonderful to me. With my life laid down, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is wonderful, it's wonderful to me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Good morning and welcome back to worship with us here at Emmanuel Baptist Church. This morning for our responsive reading, we will be reading from Psalm chapter 108. So please read with me responsively from God's Word. My heart, O God, is steadfast. I will sing and make music with all my soul. Awake, harp and lyre, I will awaken the dawn. I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples. For great is your love, higher than the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Save us and help us with your right hand, that those who you love may be delivered. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word this morning.
Good morning. This morning, John's message is on the church, and the actual verse that goes with the hymn we're about to sing is, I lay a precious cornerstone for a sure foundation. That's from Isaiah 28:16. In the New Testament, Peter testifies to Jesus that thou art the Christ, and Jesus said, upon this rock I will build my church. We're going to sing The Church's One Foundation, hymn 277. Join with us, please.
Father, we take time this morning again to acknowledge that in the middle of everything else happening, when every other foundation when every other thing that we could come to depend on seems to be shifting and unstable. We are grateful that you are eternal and that you are the firm foundation of our faith, and you are the firm foundation of your church. Lord, I pray that you would lead us this morning. You would engage us and remind us that our hope rests on nothing and no one else other than you. Thank you again that you promise us a hope that does not disappoint, that you are faithful every day to renew your promises, to renew your covenant, and to lead your people. Father, thank you for this time that you have designated and that you have set aside. We pray that you would use it, that you would teach us, you would glorify yourself in our hearts and in our thoughts. Again, Lord, we are grateful. And now, Father, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I miss all of your smiling faces. It's been kind of different videoing these without you all here. Today, I brought with me my pink toolkit. And there's something interesting about a toolkit. You have a lot of different tools. Because if I want to hang a picture, I'm going to need to use a hammer. But if I want to fix the legs of my chair, most likely I'm gonna have to screw them with a screwdriver. And let's say that I'm making something and I need it to be a certain length, so I'm gonna need to use a measuring tape. So a toolkit has so many different purposes, which is like kind of like us. In our faith, God has given all of us a special gift or a talent, just like a hammer is used to pound in nails, a screwdriver is used to screw in screws, a tape measure is used to measure certain things. We're kind of like this toolkit. God gave some of us the ability to teach, some of us the ability to be artists or to build things or to find cures for different diseases. We are just like this toolkit. So I want to read to you a verse from 1 Corinthians. It is verse 4 through 6. It says, there are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but the same God works all of them in all men. So what I would like for you all to do is to find one of your gifts that God has given you, and I want you this week to think of something you could do for somebody else to share your gift. All right, let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for all of the gifts you've given us. Help us to use those to glorify you. Help us to reach out to others and let them know that we love them. We love you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
But for this week's ministry moment, we thought it would be appropriate and good for us at the church to come alongside our college students who have recently graduated and are heading to the next step in life. And so we have four of them in our bulletin. So if you receive our bulletin in email, you will have this information. But we want to go ahead and recognize them now. So I'm going to read their graduate information. You should see pictures on your screen as I read about each graduate. So first we have Kaylee Beaver, who graduated magna cum laude from Marshall University with a degree in elementary education. She plans to pursue a teaching job, hopefully somewhere in Kentucky or West Virginia. Kylie Lalamont graduated summa cum laude from Marshall University with a BFA in visual arts. She will be interning once again for the Parkersburg Art Center, and in her own words, she will be weaving pretty things in her parents' basement. Next, we have Mackenzie Sims, who graduated summa cum laude from West Liberty University with a degree in elementary education. While being named Outstanding Elementary Education Major of the Year, and was a student speaker for her commencement ceremony. She plans to pursue a teaching job somewhere near Wheeling, West Virginia. Finally, we have Shay Woodburn, graduating summa cum laude from Ohio University's Honors Tutorial College with a Bachelor of Arts in Political Science, a minor in History, and a certificate in Law, Justice, and Culture. She has also been accepted to and plans to attend George Washington University of Law in Washington, D.C. in the fall. To all four of you and your families, we are so proud of you. As a church, we celebrate with you, and we continue to pray for you as you take the next steps in whatever God has for your life. Know that as a church, we continue to want to be here for you and support you however we can. Great job.
Hey, church family, this is Kaylee Beaver. I'm a recent graduate of Marshall University with my bachelor's degree in elementary education. Please pray for me as I search for the job that the Lord has for me.
This week, as I mentioned to you, I was able to spend some time in Missouri with my father and my three sisters. On Tuesday of this last week, our finance team had their meeting, and as all meetings right now at our church are on the Zoom video conference platform. So in Missouri, I'm joining with our finance team, and our treasurer has figured out how to put the statements up on the screen while we're on the conference, and so we're looking at all the summaries. Bottom line is the giving continues to be very strong through this time, and I just want to thank you. Our finance team is very grateful. People have been giving to the Benevolence Fund, and so we're able to use that to help a lot of people. So if you want to continue to give, online giving is a great way to remember us. The best way to connect with that is to go to our website, ebcwv.com, and then if you go up into the header, you'll see give. You hit give, and it'll bring you into our PushPay platform. Also, a number of you are just sending your tithes and your offerings to the church, and that's another great way to do it. We give of our time, and we also give of our talents, and so I'm really glad that Logan Azell was willing this week to share a great song, My Lord, What a Morning, and you're going to hear that as our offertory.
My Lord,
One thing we always do in our services is try to remember some of the great things that God is doing, and so we share praises. I was really thankful to be able to get back home this week to see my family. Tammy Hayes has said she continues to feel blessed by all the people that are remembering her. Bob Byers got back to me recently. He's feeling better, and he loves Psalm 121. Our staff, our board of ministry, and our deacons all met by Zoom this week to discuss reopening, and that all went well. Judy Prater has been collecting stories called Angels Among Us, and this week she highlighted all the people that have been helping Terry Day, who is taking care of her three grandchildren. Rose Wood bought diapers, Jewel Lusk, teddy bear and blankets, and a pack and play. Jeff Evans paid for three car seats. Terry Fielder bought a new baby swing and had it delivered. And my wife, Mona, would like to take the lead to continue to help Terry into the future. And so you can contact Mona, text her through her cell or email her. Just call the office and we'll give you the information. But we know that those needs are going to continue. Mona sent a thank you that's in our bulletin, just thanking people for all the kindness and the prayers as she's recovering from foot surgery. And I want to read the thank you from Phyllis Bennett. She said, "My lovingly kind church family, I thank you for the cards, phone calls, for all those who have prepared meals and those who have delivered them. How I miss you all. I feel greatly blessed. The words that come to mind as I think of each of you are from Numbers 6. The Lord bless you and watch over you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you." I add my amen. Love, Phyllis Bennett. Some people we need to remember in prayer would be Jeff Beatty, who's recovering from knee surgery, Nancy Duty up at Eagle Point, Monica Fowler doing chemo, Leandra Moreland, who's now at Selby General, Mary Nichols, who's very sick at Worthington, Judy Falscraft, Dale's Lowther's wife, Tara Settle, friend of Courtney Johnson and a teacher at McKinley that's on leave. Her cancer has recurred and she needs prayers. Beverly Walkup needs to be in our prayers, as does Brenda Wheeler, who's having knee surgery on June 2nd. Also, Scott Whitlatch should be in our prayers at the passing of his father, Ray Whitlatch. And the service for them was yesterday on Saturday. We had a memorial service. I wanted to point out the banner. It says One Nation Under God. That was given by Lynn Nicholson in honor of her father, Bill Stump, who was a veteran and served in the Army. This being Memorial Day weekend, we are grateful to remember those people that served our country faithfully. A while ago, Bob Byers gave me this little poster that's up on my bulletin board. It said, "Only two defining forces have ever offered to die for you, Jesus Christ and the American soldier. One died for your soul, the other died for your freedom." It's good to remember on this Memorial Day weekend that we have people that served faithfully. While I was home in Missouri, I was with my dad and sister, and we went by Maplewood Park, and there's the family cemetery there. And for a moment, I stood over the grave of my Uncle Kurt. He was born in 1925. He died in 1945 in the Battle of the Bulge. He was a medic. He was a chaplain's assistant, and he was a conscientious objector. He would not carry a gun, but he served as a medic. If you watch the movie Hacksaw Ridge, you can understand what my uncle went through. On one side of the gravestone of my uncle is a parachute, because he was in the 101st Airborne, and on the other side of his gravestone was Romans 8. And I'll be beginning a series from Romans 8. It's always been a special passage of scripture for me. But just being there reminded me of my uncle that gave his life for our country, and we need to honor those that have served faithfully and given all this Memorial Day weekend. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for the praises. We have a lot to thank you for, and every Sunday we just go back and remember that we have angels among us. We have people that are looking out for others. Like the story of the Good Samaritan, we can pass by on the other side, or we can stop and we can tend to those in need. Father, this week I was just overwhelmed with the number of unemployed that have the millions of people that have filed for unemployment in our country. And there is a despair and an urgency right now as people try to figure out how they're going to make a living and how they're going to get back to their lives again. And so, Father, we pray that we can be mindful that in this time, it's very difficult for a lot of people. And if we're able, we can come alongside others. We can share with them. We can listen to them. We can tend to their physical needs, but we can also point them to Jesus Christ, who died for their sin. And Father, we especially want to remember on this Memorial Day weekend those that have given all. Father, I'm named after my Uncle Kurt, who gave his life gave the ultimate sacrifice of his life in the World War II. And I pray, Father, that I will be a good example to others, and having that name is a reminder of someone who set a good example. And we thank you today for Jesus, who gave his life for us so that we might know forgiveness and eternal life. Continue to use this service and bless John as he brings the message to us now. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. As John prepares to preach on what it means to be the church, the only way for us to really be what God called us to be is for our hearts to be changed and completely given over to the Lord Jesus Christ. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me, this is what I pray. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you.
Last week, we took some time to look at how the church and you as the church is called by God to ministry, and how that calling has been the same from the time Scripture was written, and it hasn't changed to the present day. And so again, I want to remind all of us that according to Scripture, we have been called by God to ministry. We have been equipped through the teaching of Scripture, and we are empowered by the Holy Spirit for the works of ministry. Each and every believer empowered to bring the kingdom of God into this place. And it's that last point that I really want to focus on today. Last week, we didn't have a whole lot of time to really get into and unpack the idea of what it means to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. And to be perfectly honest, we really don't have enough time today either to unpack what all of that means. There's so much involved with understanding what it means to be empowered and led and fueled by the Holy Spirit. We could be here for days talking about it. And so this morning, what I'd like to do is to look at some practical examples from Scripture of everyday, and again, non-pastor, non-preacher believers being empowered by the Spirit in ways that aren't always obvious to us. Okay, so that we can have an idea of how it might look today, how it might feel today to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. Before we do that, though, it is very important for us to be aware of a core truth here, of a core truth about the purpose and role the Holy Spirit plays in our lives. You see, before Jesus was crucified, before he left this place, he had a conversation with his disciples. And in that conversation, they were worried, they were upset, they were sad to hear that he was going to be leaving them soon. And so in words of comfort and in words of love, he promises them that even though he is leaving, there is another coming, another like him who will teach them, who will lead them, who will guide them. And he promises them the coming of the Holy Spirit. So I want to read from John chapter 16, starting in verse 13, because we need to see how the Holy Spirit carries on the ministry of Jesus Christ in the here and now. So in John chapter 16, starting in verse 13, Jesus is talking to his disciples and he says, "But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will glorify me because it is from me that he will receive what he will make known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said the Spirit will receive from me what he will make known to you." And so what Jesus is saying there when he says the Spirit will receive from me what he will make known to you, is he's saying the Holy Spirit will carry on the ministry that Jesus inaugurated in his lifetime. You see, a lot of times we think that the only reason Jesus came was to die on the cross for us. And certainly that's a crucial part. I don't want to minimize that. That is absolutely a crucial reason why Jesus had to come, to die for our sins so that we could receive eternal life. But if that was the only reason why he had to come, he would not have had to spend 3 years in formal ministry. He would not have had to wait 33 years to reach that goal. Instead, most of what we read in the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the majority of those books tell us how Jesus lived, and more importantly, how he trained, taught, and equipped his disciples to carry on his ministry after he left. And so the Holy Spirit continues that. It is the same Spirit over and over again. We read in Scripture this idea that the Holy Spirit is the same Spirit that rose Jesus from the grave, now indwells believers. The same Spirit that distributes to some the gift of teaching and to some the gift of prayer and to some the gift of prophecy or the gift of healing or whatever gifts, all those different gifts, but one and the same Spirit. And so I want us to see this morning how it doesn't matter what your particular calling is, the same Spirit that Jesus passed on to his disciples, the same Spirit that imbued his ministry and their ministry, is the same Spirit that calls you and empowers you and wants to use you to do amazing things today. And even though we know this, as I mentioned last week, a lot of us still struggle to know what it feels like or to know what it looks like to have the Holy Spirit use us. We think about the early church and how after Jesus ascended and he commissioned his disciples, we have this phenomenal event on the day of Pentecost when the early church was anointed and filled with the Holy Spirit, and they went into the streets and began to preach and evangelize in different languages. And so a lot of times when we think being filled with the Holy Spirit, that's the image that comes to mind. And we think that's the only way that you can be filled with the Spirit. That's what it looks like. And so when we think about ourselves being called to ministry, we think, well, who am I? You know, I can't do those things. I'm just me. I'm not some evangelist. I'm not some miracle worker. I'm no saint. And yet the Holy Spirit empowers us anyway. And the same Spirit that empowered that church over 2,000 years ago, on the day of Pentecost, is the same Spirit that empowers us today. So to get us started, we're going to look at a few ways in Scripture that the Holy Spirit empowered the early church. First, in Acts chapter 2, right after the day of Pentecost, right after those events, where over 3,000 people get saved because of the testimony of Christ spoken through the disciples by the power of the Holy Spirit, we read in Acts chapter 2, starting in verse 42, that this is how the early church responded to that. It says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. So there it is. Remember last week we talked about that we are equipped by the teaching of Scripture. And so the early church is devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. And so the first thing I want to point out that the Holy Spirit empowers the church to do is he empowers the church to be generous and to be joyful as we sacrifice for those who are in need. He empowers us to generosity. He empowers us to selflessness and to self-sacrifice in pursuing and providing the needs of others. Let's read again what they did. It says in verse 44, all the believers were together. They had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes, ate together with glad and sincere hearts. And what I really want to point out about this passage is what we don't see. And we can't know for sure, but what we don't see is someone programming this. This is not a church program. There's not a leader here who is gathering everyone together and saying, okay, we have these needs, so everyone needs to go home, find something they don't want or find something that they don't need that they're willing to sell, go sell it, and then bring it back, and then we're going to develop a program to help those in need. There was no obligation. There was no coercion. There was no one that was driving that effort. It was merely the church who had been devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching, and they had been devoting themselves to fellowship. And by the power of the Spirit, they became aware of needs around them, and they acted as they believed the gospel would have them act. No obligation, no manipulation, no coercion. Just meeting the needs of others and rejoicing and praising God along the way. See, many of us have at one time or another fallen victim to some kind of emotionally manipulative guilt trip. Maybe someone comes on your TV or there's a guest speaker at church or somehow someone has your attention and they use that time to make you feel guilty for not giving enough or not doing enough or not sacrificing enough. And they lay this burden of guilt upon God's people that says that God's given you all of these things and you're being selfish with them. And I want to tell you that that is not the way the Holy Spirit moves. As an example, I remember a story when I was really young. I was probably 7 or 8 years old, and our family went trick-or-treating to the local mall. And so the mall was filled with kids going around trick-or-treating, and there is a guy there who was going around, and he was giving kids half dollars, silver half dollars, these 50-cent coins. And I was 7 years old, and I'd never seen one of these before. I'd only ever heard of them. So he was going around giving these out, and he puts one in my bag, and I was blown away by how big this coin was. And I was so excited. 50 cents back then could still get you something. And so I was so excited to finally have this cool looking coin. I was so excited to maybe get to use it. And I remember getting home, and someone else in my family, who will remain unnamed since this is going out to Facebook Live, someone else in my family asked me if I would give them my coin to add to their collection. I was 7 years old, and I was so excited about this. I was so eager to spend it and use it. And you can imagine I was like, well, no, I want to keep it. Well, you would have thought that I had committed the most heinous crime against this person because of the guilt trip that they laid upon me after I said no. When I refused, I was told that I was being ungrateful, that I was being selfish, that I wasn't thinking about other people, all because I didn't want to give up this little 50-cent coin. And I felt terrible. I remember feeling so unworthy. And little 7-year-old Jonathan came to the conclusion that he didn't deserve so fine a gift for being so thoughtless. And I remember going and getting it and surrendering it over because I just had this burden of guilt. You know, and sometimes we think that's how God is with us. I've never forgotten that guilt trip. It stayed with me forever, and the other person involved has probably long forgotten about it. But we think somehow that's what God does with us. That every time we see something we could be doing, we feel some overwhelming sense of guilt and obligation. And that's not what God wants. This is not how the Holy Spirit works. If you are giving or serving or sacrificing out of a sense of obligation, guilt, or coercion, then you need to stop right now. That's not what God wants. That's not what God needs. Look at how the people in Scripture gave. Look at how they sacrificed. This is how you know the difference between when the Holy Spirit empowers your giving and when it's just human manipulation. When the Holy Spirit empowers giving, it says, they broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts. Their hearts were glad, praising God and enjoying the favor of all people. To give with that level of generosity, to give with that level of rejoicing, that is Spirit-empowered sacrifice. So when you feel like you're not doing enough for God, when you feel this burden of guilt, know that that is not from God. That is not how the Holy Spirit works. He moves in you with joy. He moves in you with gladness and excitement to be a part of what he's doing. The Spirit also empowers the church to spiritual discernment and understanding of Scripture. And it's important that we remember this because a lot of times we think that the only people who are qualified to understand Scripture are those who are called to pastoral ministry, those who are preachers or missionaries or teachers or pastors. And in fact, again, we read over and over again that it's the same Spirit who teaches. So the same Spirit who anoints and who uses the ministries and the teachings of evangelists like Peter and Paul is the same Spirit that empowers you. And so we need to remember that he has given all of us the ability to understand spiritual truth. The church can get itself into trouble when it allows exclusive access to spiritual understanding to only pastors and teachers. This is how cults are formed. If the only person you think has the ability to understand scriptural truth is the pastor or the preacher, then that is simply not what we see in Scripture. We're going to read from Acts chapter 17, starting in verse 11. This is one of my favorite verses because this should be empowering to all of God's people. Okay, so Paul is on his missionary journeys. This is Paul we're talking about. Paul, who's been going around planting churches, he's evangelized to thousands, if not tens of thousands of people. He's written most of the New Testament, okay? So he is a pillar of the early church movement. He's a father of missionary work, okay? And here in Acts chapter 17, and in verse 10, he comes into this place called Berea. It says, as soon as it was night, the believers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. On arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now the Berean Jews were of more noble character than those in Thessalonica, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. As a result, many of them believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. So listen to what it says happened here. It says that Paul went and he was preaching like he always did. And instead of just receiving that teaching, instead of simply hearing Paul and listening to Paul and maybe even agreeing with Paul, the scripture commends the Berean believers because they took it a step further. It says they received the message with great eagerness and then examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. So they were fact-checking Paul against their own scriptures at home. And this is something that I think a lot of people in the church don't realize. You have been empowered by the Holy Spirit to understand scripture. And sometimes we think, oh, I just come to church and I let the church leaders do all the teaching. I let the church leaders do all of the studying and the interpreting and the understanding. And part of that's okay because that's partly what we're here for. But that's not where it should end. You see, Jesus warned during his time on earth that in the end times, there would come false prophets. There would come people who would raise themselves up as spiritual leaders and deceive even Christians, even believers would be deceived by these false prophets. Well, how will you know if who you're listening to is a false prophet or a genuine prophet? If what they say agrees with Scripture, agrees with God's Word? And how will you know if what they say agrees with God's Word if you're not studying it yourself? You see, the Bereans were eager to hear Paul. They liked what he had to say, but they also were willing to go back home and study and examine. And that word examine in the original Greek, it doesn't mean just casually reading. It's the same word used in a courtroom when a lawyer would cross-examine a witness, digging, searching for truth. And so they examined scriptures to see if what Paul was saying was real. And I've known of other pastors and other so-called spiritual leaders who don't allow this. They don't allow themselves to be questioned. They don't allow themselves to be fact-checked. They demand absolute compliance and obedience from their congregations. They claim exclusive understanding, and they wave around their titles and their accomplishments and their education as a means of intimidating their congregations into silence. God doesn't expect you to just believe everything you hear. God expects you to know Scripture. The Spirit empowers you to know Scripture. And I can tell you, as a teacher, that nothing brings me more joy. And I don't say this so that you guys will come tell me this later, okay? But nothing brings me more joy than when one of you comes up to me and says, "Hey, what you said today made me want to go home and read more for myself. What you said today got me asking questions. I'm going to go check on that scripture and read it for myself." That excites me to no end, and that's what you should be doing. You are empowered by the Holy Spirit to discern and understand scripture just as much as myself, just as much as Pastor Kurt, just as much as Peter and Paul in scripture. The same Spirit that uses us indwells you. So the church is empowered to generosity and self-sacrifice. The church is empowered to understanding and discernment of Scripture. And the church is empowered to prayer. And the Holy Spirit empowers the prayers of the church. I want to read from Acts chapter 12, starting in verse 1. And we're going to skip around a little bit, but I'm going to read verses 1 through 5 of Acts chapter 12. It says, "It was about this time that King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with a sword. When he saw that this met with approval among the Jews, he proceeded to seize Peter also. This happened during the festival of unleavened bread. After arresting him, he put him in prison, handing him over to be guarded by four squads of four soldiers each. Herod intended to bring him out for public trial after the Passover. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him." So Peter's in prison. James has just been martyred. He's just been killed by the sword. The church leaders are being hunted down by this corrupt and pagan government. And so the church itself is leaderless right now. They don't have their usual teachers. They don't have the usual people to kind of tell them what to do. And how do they respond? Scripture says the church was earnestly praying to God for him. So they don't scatter. They don't go into a panic. They don't wait around for someone to tell them what to do. They gather together and they pray. And we know from reading on in this chapter, and I'll encourage you to read on in the chapter, that through their prayers, God works a miraculous freeing of Peter from prison. And while it's happening, Peter himself doesn't even think it's real. He thinks he's seeing a vision. And by the time he comes to his senses and he realizes, oh, wow, I've been set free. He goes and sees the church that has been praying for him. So I want to start reading again in verse 12, where Peter has been freed from prison. He just realizes what has happened. It says, when this had dawned on him, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, also called Mark, where many people had gathered and were praying. Peter knocked at the outer entrance, and a servant named Rhoda came to answer the door. When she recognized Peter's voice, she was so overjoyed, she ran back without opening it and exclaimed, Peter is at the door. You're out of your mind, they told her. When she kept insisting that it was so, they said it must be his angel. It's funny, the people who were there gathered in prayer, praying for Peter, didn't even believe that it was him that had been released. I'm not sure they knew what to expect from their prayers. But Peter kept on knocking, and when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Peter motioned with his hand for them to be quiet and described how the Lord had brought him out of prison. Tell James and the other brothers and sisters about this, he said, and then he left for another place. And so God uses and empowers the corporate prayer of his people to bring about a miracle. And again, we see that it's not something that is programmed. It's not something that is even really organized all that well. It is the Holy Spirit leading God's people to pray. And God works mightily through the corporately expressed prayers of God's people. And yet it is astonishing how little we make use of this gift today. I think a lot of us maybe prefer to be doers. We prefer to be actively doing things ourselves, or we like to fix our own problems. And sometimes prayer forces us to slow down and acknowledge that there's nothing we can do for certain situations, that there are some problems we can't fix. And so prayer forces us to face our own inabilities. Or maybe we tell ourselves, well, why would I gather for prayer? I can always just pray by myself at home. And that's true, and you should be praying at home. But there's something special about the corporately gathered people of God praying together in one spirit and of one mind that seems to have a special release of God's power. Whatever the reason may be, when the church of God ceases to be a corporately praying force, then we also cease to be a vehicle for God's power and for God's kingdom here on earth. Your prayers are spirit-empowered, and the corporate prayers of the church and unity can accomplish fantastic things for the glory of God, and it often happens in unexpected ways. We don't know what specifically the church was praying for in Acts chapter 12. Maybe they were praying that Peter's trial would go well. Maybe they were praying that he would be comforted. They didn't really seem to expect that he would actually be set free. And so God's answer to their prayers was above and beyond what they were hoping for. So God is prepared to do more than we could ever ask or imagine through the indwelling power of the Holy Spirit in us. Now, again, we have examples going on here and now. We have this happening in our church here and now. Pastor Kurt mentioned earlier that Mona has been gathering supplies for Terry, who's taking care of three young children. And just as an example of how you, the church, you are living this out, I remember this week seeing Mona's Facebook post about needing these things, and I came back later. It was less than 3 hours later, Mona posted again that everything that had been needed, everything that had been requested, had been provided for by generous people in the church, stepping up in the spirit to meet the needs of others. Our church gets constant emails every week about from people on our prayer list who are expressing gratitude for the cards that you are sending, for the notes that you send, for the phone calls. We get emails saying, I feel the prayers of the church surround me in my time of crisis. So many of you have already taken this ministry to heart. So many of you are already moving out in the power of the Holy Spirit. And so for the rest of us, I would ask, are you joining with your church? Are you joining with the church in the ministry left to us by Christ to bring the kingdom to those around us? Or is there something holding you back from embracing and acting in the power and anointing of the Holy Spirit in your life? For that matter, is the Holy Spirit someone real? Or is he just this title, this ambiguous word or name that we toss around, that we use at baptisms, that we use in our prayers? Or is he a living and active, powerful part of your daily life, fueling you, inspiring you, teaching you, and revealing God to you and through you to those around you? My prayer for all of us is that we would wake up every morning with a clear sense of our God-given calling, that we would be equipped by the teaching of Scripture to live lives based on truth and compassion, and that we would move forward in ministry, empowered by the Holy Spirit to bring life and hope to a world in desperate need of Jesus. Let us pray. Father, again, we are in awe of you. We are in awe of all that you want to do and how you want to use us to do it. Father, thank you for that. Thank you for that calling. Father, we pray that you would reveal more of your Spirit to us, that we wouldn't be content to sit back. We wouldn't be content to watch others express your kingdom. Father, I pray that we wouldn't give in to guilt, as we talked about, that we wouldn't give in to any kind of feeling of obligation or manipulation, but that instead we would be filled with the joy and the power of your Holy Spirit as we pursue the ministry that you have called us to. Father, I pray you would imbue your people with a vision of the ministry of Christ. That ministry would drive us and would fuel us. We offer it all to you for your glory and for your kingdom in Christ's name. Amen.
You just heard John preach about how every one of us has a part to play in this church, and God will equip us. But the only way he'll equip us is if we ask for it. So today, let's ask. We need the Lord. Let's ask for his help to help us to be the ones, the person that he wants us to be in this, his church.
I need
Well, we hope and pray that you you are blessed by today's service and that you feel the presence of the Holy Spirit on you. And as you go from this place, that you would be empowered by him. And so once again, I want to speak the words of our benediction over each of you watching from home from Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 through 26. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Have a great week.